Well, Richard's back with us now with that special interview with one of the music industry's greats, Sir Elton John.
That's the only way to describe him, isn't it? He is a great. Last night, Elton John wound up his Australian tour with a brilliant show, his fourth at the Sydney Entertainment Centre. He is, by any standards, an absolute legend. A gifted pianist, a fabulous vocalist, a great showman, and of course, a brilliant composer. His music has provided much of the soundtrack to our lives for the past 30 years. Australia's always been a favoured playground for Elton. He's been touring here for three decades, first came in 1971. He's had extended holidays here, he followed the cricket, he even got married in Sydney. And on Sunday night, he had the ultimate Australian encounter playing at the Logies. Here's the first part of our exclusive interview with the great Sir Elton John. You are like a fine wine, sir. You get better and better with age.
Well, I think I'm playing and singing better than I've ever done now, and I'm really enjoying the live performances here. It's been a really smooth tour, which I'm very grateful for. And you always have to play well when you come down here, because I think the audiences are, you know, I've been coming down here so long. If you don't play well, they're going to say, well, you know, we saw him and he was better then. So I'm enjoying myself very much.
Elton has toured Australia 11 times, and there have been many highlights along the way. It has been a remarkable career. 40 studio albums, every imaginable award, and a succession of sold-out shows, all accompanied by a flamboyant lifestyle. So how does he, A, reflect on a career like this, and B, plan the next chapter?
Let's start in the 1990s, right? 1990, I got sober. I don't think you plan what, I mean, you plan your tours and you plan your album schedules, but everything that's happened in between, which has made my career so much more interesting since 1990, has been a complete sort of piece of luck, really. I mean,
luck maybe, talent definitely. Projects like The Lion King winning Oscars, Grammys, and a whole new legion of fans. His current album is titled Songs from the West Coast. It's back to basics, kind of. And while he's got others to star in the videos, he's happy to sing the album's praises.
I don't deliberately try and write songs for the charts, because I don't really know how to do that. But I think that was probably what was wrong with some of the work, maybe in the 80s and 90s, that I was told to write. You know, you have to have a hit single. You must have a hit single to sell an album. And after a while, you know, it's hard. And I think you lose your way, and I think I'm not knocking what I did, because what I did was from the heart, but I think what I've done with this album is found my feet again as a really creative artist, and I'm very happy about that. I tell you why I shut inside every time we begin this dangerous game. Oh, you are all in my original sin. This is my 40th album, and I cannot expect to compete radio-wise with, you know, the youngsters anymore, because I'm a 55-year-old man who gets played on a certain amount of radio stations, and we live in an ageist society now where they only play young, you know, the hip stations play young people, and so there's some great young kids around making great music, and I'm the first to promote them.
And promote them he does. He cites country artist Ryan Adams as the creative inspiration for Songs from the West Coast, and he's probably the best supporter any act could possibly wish for.
The jewels in the crown, the Ryan Adams, the Pete Yawns, the John Mayers, the Remy Shands, and, you know, the Casey Chambers, and this new girl out here called Catherine Britt, I think her name is.
Yeah.
I mean, I just got that album the other day. It blew me away. I just sent it to America, sent six copies of it to America to people, say, listen, this girl's incredible. It's great when you find someone. Spread the word. There's so much mediocrity around it, music-wise and entertainment-wise, television-wise, film-wise. Not coming out of Australia film-wise, there's so much acting talent, but there is a lot in the worldwide scene of music, and people are saying, you know, why aren't records selling anymore? Because what's out there, basically, is crap.
So there. During this interview, Elton referred often to his age, which prompted the obvious question.
Do you feel old?
No, I don't. But I mean, as I said before, we do live in an ageist society. We do, you know, record, you know, people like Jamiroquai find it hard to get played on Radio 1 in England. You know what I mean? And come on, that's ridiculous. And radio stations, it's all fragmented now. So if, you know, if you've got a great record and you're 40 years of age, it's hard to get it played on a hip radio station.
He may not feel old and certainly doesn't always act old, but he has taken on the role of a superstar elder statesman, his celebrity getting him into places where he wants not only his music, but his voice heard.
This is the government of the richest nation in history, and I'm here asking you for more money to stop the worst epidemic in history.
I was just asking Congress for $2.5 billion. Kofi Annan has asked the world for $10 billion for Africa, for AIDS, because the pandemic there is so awful. And America's fair share is 25% of that, which is $2.5 billion. So I was asking the panel headed by Senator Kennedy and Hillary Clinton and Orrin Hatch and people like that to say, you know, please. And there were four speakers, me and three other people who spoke very eloquently. And we just hope we get the right results.
And they all wanted an autograph?
No. Actually, they did, yes, but that was backstage.
He is a ripper, isn't he? Just a great gentleman, a very classy guy.
I think you summed it up yesterday, a class act.
He's a legend.
He's a bloody legend. he flies out of the country today. Safe travel, Sir Elton, and tomorrow morning on the show he opens up a bit more with us and tells us about his next trip down under.
He's coming back?
He's coming back next year.
He likes us, doesn't he?
He loves us. We love him too.
Yeah, it's reciprocated.
Songs from the West Coast is the current album. If you missed him in concert, bad luck. I think the best concert sound I've heard probably ever last night. Just so crystal clear and beautiful.
Good. Magic. I like his views on music.
I like his views on most things.
Yeah,
actually.
No, but it's interesting, you know. There's a lot of mediocrity around.
Yeah.
A lot of rubbish.
There you go.
And the good stuff you never hear.
Yeah. Well, except here on the Today Show.
Well, that's the exception.
Yeah, of course.
Thanks, Richard.
Pleasure.
Thanks, Richard.
Richard Wilkins just can't stay away from us. Good morning again.
Good morning, Steve. Thank you for that lovely introduction. Today we are proud to present the second slab of our exclusive interview with singer, songwriter, humanitarian, genius, Sir Elton John. Elton has lived much of his life in the spotlight. He has a superstar lifestyle and many famous friends. And his music has never been more popular. His songs have been cropping up all over the place. Almost Famous and Moulin Rouge. There's the ongoing success of The Lion King and, of course, his own albums. But along the way, there's been much anguish with several celebrated court cases, the most recent involving the feud with his former manager, John Reed. Their split impacting on all those who were close to them, putting many in impossible situations, ending friendships, severing associations, and costing a fortune.
It was tough. You're with someone for 27 years as your manager, and it kind of evaporates, and you find things that shock you. And I don't want, you know, John has his own life now, and I have mine. And do I want to see him particularly? No, I don't. And does he particularly want to see me? I don't think so either. It's just that part of my life has gone. It was very painful to deal with because of the betrayal and the loyalty issue. Not so much because of the money. That did come into it, but the loyalty thing is the thing with me. And when people here, who I've been coming and working with for a long time, chose sides, then I had to say, you know, I'm very hurt by that, and they have no part or place in my life anymore.
Elton does, however, still have some way to go before he gets the legal judgment he was looking for.
I had to go to court last year and sue Price Waterhouse, and the judge's verdict was that I lost, and then I won the right to appeal, which is very healthy, and that comes up for review in June or July. I believed I was right, and you have to accept the verdict, which I thought was wrong, and now I've got the chance to reverse that.
Whilst Elton has new management, he's been in a stable personal relationship for over 5 years, sharing his heart and his home with partner David Furnish. But where exactly is home these days?
If I've got Venice, which I'm going to move into in May the 6th, with David, it's a little apartment, which is so beautiful.
Little,
one kitchen, one living room, one guest bath, one guest toilet, bedroom, bathroom, and closet, that's it. It's kind of like a pied-à-terre in the most beautiful view. Got South France, Nice, Atlanta, London, and Windsor, which is the hub. And I'd like to spend maybe a little more time appreciating what I've, you know, been working towards for the last few years.
This train don't stop. This
train, don't stop. He is, of course, a self-confessed workaholic with an enormous capacity to take on numerous big projects.
I'm working as hard as I've ever done and enjoying it. But I've never had so much fun. I've never, you know, I seem to cram more into a day and enjoy it than I ever did before. And I do have, you know, it seems like I work a long time and I work a lot. But I do have time to pursue other things.
So how does he handle such a pace?
While I have the energy, I'm going to throw my energy into as many creative projects as possible. So in the future, there's going to be a new Elton John album starting in January.
Hang on. Did he say new Elton John record? Wasn't he quoted recently as saying he'd never record again?
You know me, I'm all mouth and you know me of old. You know, I was having a horrible night on stage one night, and I have had a tough time with my record company in America. Because it's been like batting your head against a brick wall. Everywhere else, all the other territories have been pretty, you know, decent. And it's been, you know, you get really, really, really kind of frustrated sometimes.
All right, so back to the good stuff. A new album, what else?
There's going to be a Billy Elliot musical emerging sometime in the future. There's going to be The Lion King coming over here with Aida.
You're coming back too, aren't you?
I'm coming back next year, hopefully in March, April. To do a solo tour, which I've done worldwide, and I'm going to come back and do that because I never did it in Australia, and I did it everywhere else, and I did about 250 shows with me and the piano, and it was superb, and I just thought, you know what, I'd really like to come back, maybe play some different venues. We did a stately home tour of Britain, which was fun, except the weather was crap, but over here, I don't think you're going to have to worry too much about the weather as far as it being warm, so I'll probably do some wineries, I'll do some really venues that people won't expect me to do, and I'm really looking forward to that. That'll be next year.
So there you go, only 11 months to go till Elton returns. His current album, Songs from the West Coast, is a beauty. It's out now, and I'll catch you tomorrow.
Thank you, Richard.
Pleasure.
Thanks, Rich. Now, we have to do a little bit of housekeeping. Mm-hmm. We were